Hi everyone, Nina here. I'm really sorry I can't be there in person this morning, but unfortunately the Maxwells are all self-isolating. But today we're going to carry on looking at the summer series of the I Ams of Jesus. And today I am looking at I Am the Door, or the Gate of the Sheep, from John 10 verse 1 to 10. And next week Russ is going to bring us the second half of this with I Am the Shepherd. John 10 verse 1 to 10. Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought them out, all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him, for they do not know his voice. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved, and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief only comes to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and live it abundantly." Just to do a little recap as to where we're up to. In the previous chapter, Jesus had just miraculously healed a blind man, but the Pharisees were only concerned with what they felt were the rules that had been broken, and they wanted to see Jesus punished for it. They failed to see the evidence of what Jesus had done as evidence of his divinity, and Jesus calls them out on their unbelief. He accuses them that it is in fact they who are blind for not getting the gist of what he's revealing to them. Here in John 10 verse 1 to 10, Jesus reveals more to them about who he is. Despite being very familiar with all things to do with sheep and shepherds and sheep pens, they were still not understanding the analogy and were failing to understand the real message. They didn't get that this was so much more than a story about keeping livestock. Firstly, I thought to help us unpick and understand this cryptic puzzle, we could have a look at a picture of a sheep pen. But I don't know whether that's going to be possible today now. I know that we had a problem with images and copyright and what have you. So if there is anything there, then brilliant. And otherwise, I'll just explain. They would be dotted around the hillside. They'd be typical for the time and region, built out of stone, a bit like stone, dry stone wall work. They would put them together as soon as they settled, and others would already be dotted around the landscape, ready for the flock and the shepherds to settle somewhere. They might have twigs perhaps interwoven over the top to give some protection from above, but they would predominantly just be sturdy stone wall sides. As you can see, or maybe not see, there was no entrance door. It was just a gap in the wall. And so the shepherd or gatekeeper would use their own body to form the door or the gate, and literally become a human door. And what a responsibility that was for them. Sometimes there would even be more than one flock inside, belonging to more than one shepherd, which must have been a logistical challenge for them to sort out. We only have to look at live wires and bright sparks pickup to imagine the moment the doors opened and each shepherd had to find his own flock. But luckily, like children and parents, the sheep too would rely on recognising and following the voices of those they knew and trusted. We teach our kids from an early age about stranger danger because of the risk of going off with someone with bad intentions. And Jesus was spreading the same message here. The gatekeeper had two main jobs. Firstly, to keep safe and secure those that were on the inside. And secondly, to keep unwelcome visitors out. Much like a bouncer on the doors of a nightclub, he was responsible for the well-being of those inside. And in one of the study guides, it said that the protection of the sheep was only as good as the power of the gate. They would be prepared to literally lay their lives down in order to protect their flock. That should start like sounding like somebody we know. He also had to be on high alert of any infiltrators or thieves that might try and break in and pretend to be shepherds in order to steal the sheep away from the security of the real shepherd. And this reminded me of when I was somewhere that I shouldn't have been, when I once found myself on stage being filmed at the Dome nightclub in Birmingham, surrounded by professional dancers. If you're not familiar with the iconic 1990s late night students' favourite programme, The Hitman and Her, it was hosted by Michaela Strachan and Pete Waterman, and they would tour the university cities of the UK and present from a different venue each week. Students would be invited to take part in various challenges, games, karaoke performances, and it was interspersed with performances from professional dancers. Well, at some point, my friend and I just decided that we'd remain on stage after whatever competition we'd just been up for. And so, for about the next hour or so, I had the time of my life. Thousands looked on. I think my mum might even have a VHS tape of it somewhere. Anyway, as convincing or not as our dancing may have been, it all came unstuck when we actually left the stage as the dancers started to file off to go backstage. And we came face to face with the stage manager, who obviously did not recognise us, and we didn't know him. And at that point, we were booted back into the crowd and into obscurity. Luckily, no harm was done. We didn't have any bad intentions, but the reality is, we could have been anyone, and we could have had an agenda. You can't always trust something that looks the part on the outside or seems to be authentic without actually being sure. In our case, there wasn't much more at stake than just our pride, but for the sheep, there was a lot more at stake as to who they followed. And that means so much more is at stake for us too. We are his sheep, and Jesus wants to protect us, and he wants us to be safe in the security that he offers, and alert to those that may try and sneak over the wall, trying to pass themselves off as the real thing. The book Pilgrim's Progress gives us some helpful further insight here, and I know Craig recommended this book the other week, and I'm going to recommend it again. If you haven't read it, it tells the story of our hero Christian, who has a strange dream about a man, a burden, a book, and a city facing destruction. So he sets out on a journey of his life, facing many threats and temptations along the way as he heads to the celestial city. There's a bit where Christian encounters two intruders who have just leapt over the fence next to him and joined him on his road. In the original version, they're called formalist and hypocrisy, but I think the kids' version helps us to understand the scenario better as they're called Mr. On the Surface and Mr. Pretender. When Christian challenges them for not coming through the gate as the master had instructed, they laugh at him and say that their people have been taking that shortcut for years and they don't care if it's breaking the rules. They even gloat, "If we're in, we're in. Doesn't matter how we got here." But at the next crossroads, they don't like the look of the narrow road that Christian is choosing to follow, and they each choose a wider road and set off. And as we read on, neither of them survived the journey. One entered a dark wood called Danger and lost his way forever, and the other stumbled and fell along the rough ground called Ruin and never got up again. We need to be careful that, like Christian, we continue to choose the right place to put our trust, even when faced with other options that may seem credible. Like these imitators, Jesus warns us about dangerous fakers whose intention is to deceive, and that's what the Pharisees were doing, trying to bypass Jesus and peddling instead their own rules for salvation. Jesus wants all fakery exposed. He is the only way, and other ways are dangerous. Verse 10 makes this very clear. The thief only comes to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they might have life and have it abundantly. I certainly don't think the Pharisees would have recognized themselves as the thieves and bandits that Jesus was talking about here. On the contrary, they saw themselves as above reproach and as pinnacles of righteousness. But theirs is not the kind of righteousness that gives life. We're to seek his righteousness and to avoid the sin of self-righteousness at all costs, as it can only ever lead to destruction. In Acts 4, verse 12, Peter and John, when they're speaking to the rulers and elders of the law in their defense at having been seized for making claims of Jesus's divinity, leave us in no doubt when they say, "There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name in all of heaven for people to call on to save them." some people resent Jesus being the only gate through which to enter. To them, it sounds an arrogant claim, and they much prefer the modern popular view that we all have our own equally credible truths and always lead to heaven. In Unitarianism, the afterlife can be whatever you want it to be, and salvation is a non-issue, as they believe that sin doesn't even exist. In Hinduism, hard work and wisdom is the gateway to heaven. In Buddhism, works are essential to reach nirvana, and one must follow the eightfold path. Right view, right response, right speech, right conduct, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right mediative absorption. Phew! No wonder it's widely accepted that no normal person could ever achieve this, and it's only really left to monks to have a go. For the Pharisees, it was strictly adhering to the many rules and regimes that were in place. Jesus was trying to get them to see that he alone is the answer, and if they missed that, then no amount of works was going to do them any good. And worse than just deceiving themselves, they then had they were spreading the message to others, their version of the route to salvation, and they risked stealing their salvation too. The message of John 10 is Jesus is the gate. No one gets in except through him. Cheats and impersonators offer nothing, and we're only deceived. The good news for us is that all are welcomed by Jesus. Jesus loves us and wants us to get to know the voice of our Lord better, so we will be able to tell what is from him and what is dangerous deception. We do need to know the difference. Our salvation relies on it. So let's keep encouraging each other. Let's keep encouraging each other to open our Bibles, to spend time in his word, to pray together, to sing songs of worship together, and let's let Jesus take care of us now and for all eternity. Thanks very much, guys. I think probably it would be a good idea now if we ended in prayer. Lord Jesus, thank you that you are the sole door, the sole gate for the sheep. Thank you that you love us and you want to take care of us and you want to protect us for those that would wish us ill. May we know you and your voice better day by day, and may that be a further protection for us and a confidence that we can have as we go into our everyday. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thanks so much, guys. I'm sure the worship group are going to be back on. So see you soon. Bye.